Without any further ado, I'm going to introduce Matt Arens, who is the co-founder of ZFS and father of OpenZFS. And he's going to give a quick introduction for this 2018 developer OpenZFS Developer Summit.
Awesome. Thanks, Pavel. So I want to start off just by thanking everyone who's made this possible. First off, thanks to Aaron Holding. He's designed all of our graphics for the past 5 years. So that's what you see on your awesome t-shirts that you got today and the badges and everything else. Thanks a lot, Aaron. And you know, this conference doesn't just go on by magic. There's a lot of people doing a lot of work behind the scenes, so I wanted to make sure to thank them. First off, thanks to my colleague, Karen Ritter, for overall project management. Karen, thank you. And thank you to Victoria Favreau, who does the event management. If any of you have sponsored the conference, you undoubtedly dealt with her. She makes sure that all the bills, all the checks get cashed and all the bills get paid. So thank you very much, Victoria. Thanks to Pavel, who's the MC for today. Thanks a lot. He's going to make sure that all the speakers run on time. And I hear that he has a giant hook that will be used as necessary. And lastly, thanks to SPI. SPI does the financial management for OpenZFS. And next, I wanted to thank all the companies that have made this possible through financial donations. So first, thanks to our Diamond sponsors, starting with Datto. Is anyone here from Datto? Yeah, thank you guys. And thank you to Delphix. Anybody here from Delphix? My employer also, thank you very much, Delphix. And OS Nexus, anyone from OS Nexus? Yeah, thank you guys. Platinum sponsors, New Isis, is that the correct pronunciation? Anybody here from New Isis? Did I get it right? Okay, New Isis, thank you. And thank you to our gold sponsors, Nexenta, IX Systems, Racktop, and Sineto. Folks from those companies, raise your hands. Yeah, thank you. And our silver and bronze sponsors, FreeBSD, silver and our bronze sponsors, DillOS and Revert. Thank you. So I have two things that I wanted to talk about at this intersession today. And the first one is providing some transparency as to the financials of running the conference. I certainly was in the dark about this before we started running the conference. Like, how do you actually, where does the money, like what actually costs money? Like, is $50 a ticket really enough to fund a conference like this? So I want to start off by saying OpenZFS is still an associated project with SPI. We started this, I think, almost 2 years ago. SPI is software in the public interest. They're a nonprofit, so basically this allows us to store all of our funds, money, other assets with SPI. They hold that, and then they can write checks and enter contracts, like, for example, with this venue on our behalf. So if you'd like to make donations, they're a 501c3 tax-deductible nonprofit that you can make donations to OpenZFS through SPI. So where does the money come from to run the conferences? As you can see, registration is a pretty small piece of the pie, 8% last year, and this year, 3%. Most of the money comes from the top tier sponsors. So last year, we had 6 platinum sponsors. This year, we have 3 platinum and diamond sponsors. And that's where most of the money came from. And I broke out Delphix separately here, and I'll go into why that is in a moment. But I wanted to point out that sponsorship is kind of opaque to us. Like, we ask a bunch of companies that are involved with ZFS if they'd like to be known as strong members of our community, and there's other benefits as well to sponsoring us. But usually we don't get a lot of feedback. Like, when people don't choose to sponsor us, they don't usually write back and say, hey, like, I really would have liked to sponsor you, but this one thing that you're doing turns me off, or like, we just didn't have enough money or whatever. Like, usually it's like we send some emails and then we just don't get any responses, and then they don't sponsor us, right? So, you know, that's fine. That's not necessarily a bad thing, but it means that we don't have a lot of visibility into, like, from the sponsor's point of view, what are we doing right? What are we doing wrong? And, what could we do to get more money? Like, it's not always clear to us what we could do to raise more money. The one thing that we did do this year is that we added a new higher sponsorship level, Diamond. And these levels are basically exponential. So, gold is $500, silver is $1,000. The next one is $2,000, $4,000, $8,000, which is why, you know, most of the money comes from the highest tiers. So we added this new Diamond tier. And personally, I feel like that kind of saved us financially this year because, you know, without that, those companies sponsoring at the Diamond level, they would have still sponsored us at the highest level, but it would have meant that they were at Platinum and we would have $8,000 less, which would be, you know, a big deal. The other thing I wanted to mention is just that, like, we think that the sponsorship is a pretty good value. Like, even at the very highest level, $8,000, like, that's, it's not that much compared to other similar conferences. And, you know, if you think about, like, companies that are sending a few of their employees here for the conference, they get on a plane, they need a hotel room in San Francisco, which is super expensive. So it's like, it's not that different than sending a few employees here from somewhere else in the country. So where does all that money go? Like, how do we spend it all? We tried to, this year we were a little bit short on money, so we did have to make some cuts, but we tried to maintain value in the things, maintain the things that we think bring value to the community. So first is like the video. You know, we live stream this, we record all the videos, we post them on the internet, on YouTube later on, and you know, the videos and the live stream actually get a lot more people view those than are able to attend in person. So we think that's a really good value. The venues, I had a few questions like, why does the conference like at a different time this year? Like, why do you guys keep moving it around? You know, there's a couple of reasons, but most of them are financially driven. You know, we want to find, this venue has been really good for us. We've had it here, I think, 5 or 6 years. I think every year of the conference, we've had it at this venue. The venue is only available on Mondays usually because they're open, you know, it's a museum and they're open to the public the other 6 days of the week. So the spots, you know, fill up really quickly. So, you know, we have to kind of work around the schedule availability for the venue. The venue is also it's a really good value in terms of money for what we get for it. The other thing we try to do is we try to work around other major conferences in San Francisco. Because we, in the past, like in the first couple of years, we did not do that. And it was like a real burden for folks who were coming from out of town because I don't know how much you guys paid for hotels, but it would be like twice as much, which is, I know, like unbelievable, but it does happen. Like if this is during one of these conferences that, you know, fills up all of Moscone and they have tens of thousands of visitors, like the, you know, supply and demand, hotel prices go up a lot. So we try to avoid that, which is why we moved the conference to be a bunch earlier this year. The other thing, you know, the venue here is only the first day venue. So the second day, we've always been able to find companies that will donate their space. Like last year, that was GitHub, and this year, Delphix, make their space available for the second day of the conference. Let's see, what else do I want to say? So, the food, you know, this year where we made the cuts were in the food. So you may have noticed the breakfast was not like a full breakfast spread with cooked eggs and everything else. It was just kind of snacks. After the conference, we're still gonna have the party, but it's not gonna be like a full dinner. It's gonna be appetizers and drinks. The other thing I wanted to point out, and this kind of ties with the last slide, is the big increase here from 2017 to 2018 is the staffing. So why is staffing so much more expensive? This is because basically we're surfacing some hidden costs. In past years, Delphix has covered a lot of the pre-conference staffing. So everything that goes on behind the scenes, Karen and her team has taken care of in the past. And that's been kind of like a hidden reliance or dependency on Delphix. This year, We outsourced more of that to Victoria and her company. So that's why the dollar costs here were higher, even though it's kind of like the same like actual amount of effort spent on it. And then that's why you know, Delphix sponsored gave us more dollars this year than in the past, was in part to cover that. The one thing I wanted to point out here is that you know, reliance on one company to make this event happen is really not great long term. I mean, we super appreciate everything that Delphix has done to put this on for so many years, and I think they will continue to do that. But for the community, you know, ideally we would like to get to a point where we can be self-sustaining and not have to rely on any one company as kind of like the financial or staffing backstop for the conference, as we have in the past, even if they're willing to do that. So in order to accomplish that, really what we need to do is have donations that are not associated with like one conference that we can carry over from year to year, that can kind of be like our like endowment, so to speak, that we can draw from in years where the sponsorship doesn't meet up with the expenses. I don't have a great solution here. This is something that we're gonna be working on over the next year, but we're definitely looking for ideas from folks that maybe have experience with foundations or raising money, of like, what's the right way to do that? What's the right way to like approach companies to make that sponsorship donation, or to make a donation that's not associated with the conference, and then, you know, how to manage that you know, that entity. The other thing we're going to be doing is probably raising ticket costs next year. I think this is probably the least expensive conference that I've ever attended, so we're going to be raising the cost to be more in line with other conferences. But it should still be pretty affordable. Cool. So I wanted to talk about another kind of meta issue in our community and in our industry overall. So, you know, our industry has a problem. The problem is that the industry looks a lot like myself. Representation of women and minorities in the tech industry is much lower than in all private industry. These are some stats that I got from U.S. government Equal Opportunity Commission. So this is not self-reporting. We took the numbers from whatever, you know, some of the top companies said. This is like every company has to report to the government, like, this is how many employees we have, and these are their demographics, like, as well as they can report it. So, like, you know, I don't know if you've started at a new company recently, you probably saw like in all that paperwork, they're like, hey, you can optionally tell us your gender and ethnicity, and we'll record it and report it to the government. And this is where we got this data. And if you look at like technical roles, it's even less. And open source contributor, you know, when you get to more specialized things like open source contributors, kernel programmers, for example, the representation is even much, much, much less. So, you know, some people might ask, like, well, okay, that's a fact, but what's problematic about that? Well, I think this is a problem for me because I want to work with the smartest, most creative people. And, you know, I want to write the most elegant software possible, and I want to solve the most important problems for our customers. We're missing out on a lot of valuable talent when we don't have representation from across, you know, our whole demographics. And, you know, a more diverse community brings in different points of view, and that makes our community stronger in general. So, okay, great, we have a problem, we accept that. What can our community do about this? You know, companies have different tools to deal with this than open source communities. You know, for example, recruiting and hiring, they can choose where they go to recruit. They can choose, they can do things like, you know, maybe doing blind interviews or things like that to make sure that they are removing biases from the interviewing process. But in open source community like OpenZFS, we usually can't choose who works on it. It's a volunteer army, right? So whoever shows up, we got to take what we can get. One thing we can do is to make sure that everyone who's interested in OpenZFS has a chance to participate to the maximum extent that they're able. So one way to accomplish that, to get everyone to, that wants to participate, is to make sure that everyone feels welcome in our community. So starting this year, we did one thing, one concrete thing, which is we added new ticket types for the conference. So discounted tickets for first-time attendees and for people from underrepresented groups in our community. And you know, as I mentioned, the ticket price for the conference is pretty low. Hopefully, the price is not a burden for anyone who wants to attend. But we feel like doing this sends a simple message to folks in the broader community, which is that everyone's welcome here. Like, we want you to come. We want new first-time attendees. We want people from underrepresented groups to come and be part of our community and participate. Other thing I wanted to mention, as in past years, we have a code of conduct for participation at the conference, which covers, you know, being here in person as well as interactions associated with the conference online, like the live stream. The core of our code of conduct is be considerate of others. Think about how your actions affect those around you. The code of conduct is on the website. It's also on your badge here. And you know, if something inappropriate happens, then we want to know about it. You can speak to anyone here who has a staff badge. Their badge says staff on the bottom of it. And there will always be somebody, a staff at the registration desk. The staff are me, Karen, Pavel, George, and Victoria, who I think is at the registration desk right now. Is that right? Okay. So my vision is that the code of conduct becomes a document that can help us guide us to becoming a more welcoming and open community. Right now, it's not quite there, but that's something that we want to work on over the next year, is both you know, expanding it, helping it be something that's more of a positive document, explaining, like, these are the behaviors. This is what we want everyone. We want everyone to be welcoming. Here's how to be welcoming. We want everyone to be inclusive. Here's how to be inclusive. Here's how to think about other people. And we also want to work on expanding the scope of the code of conduct to include our interactions throughout the year online as opposed to currently it's just covering the conference. So I'm always really excited about coming to the conference, and especially like seeing all the folks that I don't see throughout the year, you know, seeing my buddies from that I know from online, from past conferences, and that's really exciting. But also, I'm an introvert, and meeting all of the new people kind of, you know, puts my stomach in knots a little bit. So it's not easy for me to meet new people, and I know that's probably true of some other folks here. But but it is super valuable. Like it's super valuable both to me personally to get to know new people, and it's super valuable to the community to you know, to be welcoming and make sure that people that show up here become, you know, permanent parts of the community. And the best way to do that is by making personal connections with them. So I'm making a conscious effort to engage with folks that I don't know, people whose faces I don't recognize. And I'd like to ask all of you here, if it is not your first time, then please find somebody whose face you don't recognize and say hi to them. I am also super dork, and so in addition to being an introvert, so I like to like think about, okay, what do I say to some new person? Like, I don't recognize them. Like, what am I supposed to say to them? And so I put together a few lists of things that questions that I might ask, like, you know, hey, how did you start using ZFS? Things that you know, probably people here would all have in common, something to talk about. Or you know, if you want to gripe, I like to gripe too. Like, have you seen how simple the OpenZFS website is? Like, I couldn't find anything there. It's just like a giant piece of text. Like, and then that can lead to other questions, like, how do you think we can make this better? So with that, I'd like to welcome everyone to the 2018 OpenZFS Developer Summit.